knowing God personally means both comfort and challenge. It means grace and growth. And that's what Moses discovered and shared with the people of Israel at the end of his ministry. Hear the word of God in the 32nd chapter of Deuteronomy. When the Most High gave the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of man, he set the boundaries of the peoples according to the number of the sons of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the allotment of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the howling waste of the wilderness. He encircled him. He cared for him. He guarded him with the pupil of his eye. Like an eagle stirs up its nest that hovers over its young, he spread his wings and caught them. He carried them on his pinions. The Lord alone guided him. Let us pray. Gracious, holy, forgiving, accepting God, we thank you that you have confronted us with your own essential nature in this scripture. You've told us things about yourself that sometimes we neglect, and we want to confront those this morning. Oh, gracious God, help us to climb the heights to understand and go the depths to respond, that we may know who you are and also allow you to reach us where we are. We give you ourselves, Lord. Speak to us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. I'm constantly amazed at how the experiences of life are matched with the needs of people. Very often the questions that I'm asked are related to the experiences that I've gone through. Such was the case in understanding how to answer a very deep and profound question. I'd taken a flight from New York City to Chicago, and I was to transfer to another flight to come to Los Angeles. Well, the flight from New York was late, and so it was a breakneck move from one terminal to the other. Have you ever seen those pictures of O.J. Simpson as he runs through the... Well, that's exactly how I did it. Briefcase in one hand and a suitcase in the other, and my coattails flying. But I made it just as they closed the door behind me, and I found my seat. Well, it was hurry up and wait, I want to tell you, because we taxied out onto the runway, and there we sat. And finally, the pilot came on the intercom system and said, "I'm very sorry to tell you, but there are 23 other airplanes ahead of us. It will take at least an hour and a half before we take off." Well, I sat back and I said, how like life? I was feeling kind of a holding pattern in my own life anyhow. And so just to use the time, I got up and walked up and down the aisles. And I said, how do you feel about this? I was just kind of taking a public opinion poll. And I was amazed at the different reactions of people. Some of them were very disgruntled. Those who wanted to get to Los Angeles and had an appointment, as I had, and a time schedule, these people were very disturbed by the holding pattern. But I discovered some other people who didn't want to come anyhow. You know, who were going on business or had to do some tough things here in Los Angeles or carry out some responsibilities that they didn't want to carry out. And so they were delighted that there was a holding pattern. And they started to celebrate. I won't tell you how, but they started to celebrate. And they had a great time. Finally, we took off, and we flew breakneck speed across the country, only to find that we had to land at a nearby airport and be told that it would be impossible to take off for a while. So we were in another holding pattern. Finally, we took off from there, got into the air, and the pilot got on. He said, "Could you believe this? Los Angeles is now fogged in, and we have been put on a layer of planes circling around the airport, and we are in a holding pattern. It will probably take about an hour and 15 minutes. Well, I got home at 3 o'clock in the morning. Can you believe that? Well, I crawled into bed and I thought to myself, isn't that amazing? What an experience of being held up, put in a holding pattern. But I realized that there were people on that airplane whose inner condition matched the experience. They were in a holding pattern, and suddenly their own inner feeling of reserve and resistance was matched by the situation in which they found themselves, and suddenly they knew what was going on inside of them. Life does have its holding patterns, doesn't it? I was amazed, utterly amazed. The following week, when I was going through the thousands of questions that you had submitted, and I found one in there that matched what I'd just been through, a man actually wrote, "How do you get out of life's holding patterns?" I knew I'd just been through one. But I also knew on a deeper level, because there have been times that I've been in holding patterns when I've resisted growth or discovered that I repeat the same old patterns, things I thought I'd gotten over a long time ago. But also, there are times that I really struggle. Do you? I find I do. And I often wonder, does the Lord know I struggle? And so another question that came in the large stack of cards was, why do I still struggle if I'm a Christian? Have you ever asked that? Are you a part of the American cult of wanting to get everything settled? I am. I want every place a thing and everything a place. I want everything organized. And I keep working to try and get everything set so that nothing goes wrong. And it always does. And usually when one thing goes wrong, another thing goes wrong, and when you think you can't take one more thing, that's when it always happens. Is that ever true of any of you? Okay. Well, I discovered that often I get into these holding patterns and need to get out of them. And so did this person who asked this question. And so I put the two questions together because both of them were essentially asking the same question. How do you get out of the holding pattern? Why do we still struggle? And I want to suggest something that has become true for me. It may be true for you. I want to test it out on you. And it's this. We cannot blame God for the holding patterns of life. Most of them we create ourselves. Nor can we blame God for the struggles that we go through. But we can know that God uses every one of them. Now, I know that every one of us has some struggle right now. Some of them have been induced by other people. Others of them have been caused by circumstance. And some of them we've brought onto ourselves. Stupidity, carelessness, or just not thinking very much, or rebellion against God, and we struggle. The thing I want to say is that God knows, and He can use that struggle, that inner turmoil, to get us out of the holding pattern. So I don't know about you, but I want to say, praise God for the struggles. They help us to grow. There's a marvelous story of a little boy who found a chrysalis, one of those little tubes in which a caterpillar becomes a butterfly. And he watched that process, and he saw the movement, and he saw a butterfly begin to emerge, and he said, "Oh, I want to help." So he got a scissors, And he cut the cocoon, thinking he was helping to release the butterfly. But by taking away the struggle, the butterfly never flew. Ever feel that way? Ever wonder why there's struggle? God will not cut open the cocoon. He lets us struggle. He's with us in the midst of it. And he helps us each step of the way. Now, shift the metaphor and come right to the heart of what Moses was saying as he ended his ministry with the people of Israel. 40 years of experience with them had taught him a great deal, but his communion with God had brought him into the center of the essential nature of God's divine government, his providence, the way he worked with Israel, and the way he works with individuals. And so at the end of his ministry, there at the foot of Mount Nebo, he talked to the people. And he said, just as an eagle stirs up its nest, and just as an eagle hovers over its young, so too he spreads his wings and catches them. He carries them on his pinions. The Lord alone guided him. And in that, Moses gave us the secret of how to get out of a holding pattern. He brought to our attention 3 essential things about God. They must be held in equipoise. Each one must be given an equal distribution of meaning. God is the disturber. God is the deploying developer. And God is the deliverer. Now catch the image. God had used the image of the eagle all through Moses' life, especially during the wilderness time. You remember in the 19th chapter, the 4th verse of Deuteronomy, he explains what the Lord said to him when he first ascended Mount Sinai. The Lord said, "You have seen what I've done to the Egyptians and how I have borne you on wings of eagles." That's where it came from. Sometimes illustrations come out of the world of nature and we apply them to God. Sometimes God gives them to us and we apply them to nature. The parables of God are given to us to understand what we see going on around us. Now, at the end of his ministry, Moses drew a profound truth about how the eagle cares for its young. An eaglet is programmed to become an eagle. And the father eagle loves the eaglet enough to force that eaglet to grow. And so, step one, the disturber. After the eaglets are fed and they settle down to the lethargy of sleep, when they are at the point when it's time to learn how to fly, what does the eagle do? But soars over the nest and then begins to stir up the nest. What does that mean? But the eagle makes the nest uncomfortable, pulls out some of the straw, roughs up the smooth surfaces. It becomes difficult to stay in that nest. And so, with his feathers, pushes the little eaglets up to the edge, up to the edge of the nest, and then swoops around and gives them an example of what it means to fly. As if to say, come on, try it, try it. And when they don't, swoops around, gets behind them, and pushes them out of the nest. And can't you see them flopping down? And then the deliverer comes. the disturber, the deployer, and now the deliverer. Can't you see that majestic eagle swooping down underneath them, opening his pinions, and allowing the little birds to be caught before they fall to the ground? I don't know about you, but that's my experience of God. He has never allowed me to stay at any one stage of growth. He is the one who stirs me up. He does not cause struggle, but he uses it. And any time I struggle, I grow. And I'm thankful for it. Can you say right now, Lord, thank you for the struggles in which I am presently engaged, because through it, I'm going to get out of this nest. God never opens a door until he closes a door. Amazing illustration. After Jesus sets his face like flint to Jerusalem, right after that, the Samaritan city would not receive him. The disciples wanted to blast the city. Jesus said, no, I've got another thing to do. God always makes us uncomfortable in the old rut and presses us out of the holding pattern onto the new thing that he wants us to do. But at the same time, he flutters with us. He who is able to keep you from falling. He never lets us go too far. He's there with us in the midst of it. Lo, I am with you always. I want to tell you, I can take anything if I know he's there, and if I know he's using it, and if I know that it can be used for his glory and my growth, if I can become more and more the person he wants me to be, I say, Lord, all right, send the blast. Push me out of the nest. The wonderful truth is that just as an eaglet is made to be an eagle, so too you and I are made to be like God. We were created a little bit lower than the angels so that we might know him and love him and live with him forever. He is the deliverer indeed. Victor Hugo has that marvelous image in a little bit of prose, where he speaks of the bird that sings out on a branch, and even though the branch begins to sway, almost to break in the wind, he sings because he knows he has wings. God wants us to be the kind of people who are ready to fly. Wouldn't it be tragic to be an eaglet forever? You know, sit up there in that little nest all your life? Many people do. Many people are in kindergarten when it comes to the faith, because they live in two worlds. The worlds of crisis sweep around them, both in the world, in their community, and in their own lives. And inside is that little baby Christian, unwilling to grow up, because the only thing the person believes about God is that he's a comforter, that he makes everything all right, and that he pats us on the head and says, now, now, everything will be all right. I want you to be a baby forever. Not so. He gets us up onto the edge of that nest, and he swoops down, and whoosh, we're out learning to fly. Can you believe all that about God? Can you accept that he is a disturber and that he'll use all that you're going through right now? Broken relationships, disturbances, physical maladies, frustrations, hurts. He knows all about it. But you're programmed to grow, to fly. Can you believe that he's brooding over you right now, just as he brooded over the waters at creation and brooded over his people? God never stirs us out of the nest unless he is willing to fly right beside us as we try to learn how to use our wings. And then, when we're about to fall too far, there he is. Moses ended this magnificent talk to the people by saying, "And underneath are the everlasting arms." Do you feel them? Land and trust him. For the one who created the jet stream will teach you how to soar.